all stand and worship together today, okay?
Good Lord, show me the way.
Everybody.
Oh, I went down to the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown. Good Lord, show me the way. Good Lord, show me the way. Good Lord, show me the way.
Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus.
Come, Lord
Heart in the stream of life, let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy, as deep cries out to deep we sing, come Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Dear Lord, we come to You this morning, thirsty for Your word, thirsty for the presence of Your Holy Spirit here today. Guide us in this time we have together. We ask in Your name. Amen.
Amen. We would like to again welcome each of you out as we worship our Lord this morning. Thank you so much for coming out. We are excited to be here. We're excited to share the love of God with each other. And I want to direct your attention to the Connect card in your bulletin here. This is how we turn in our prayer requests, as well as some other ways to get connected. And we drop that in the prayer box in the foyer when we are ready, which is also where our tithes and offerings go. We continue with our sermon series this week, which is winding down from the promise to the blessing, covering the Gospel of Luke from Christmas to Easter. Easter's getting a little complicated as we get into the outreach program coming up, so we may just kind of transition out of our series into what we have. I'll explain that in the next week or two. But here we have the flyers beginning to go out in the mail for our Revelation Prophecy Conference beginning Thursday night, April 7, at our College Park Christian Academy Gymnasium. And so these flyers are going out in the mail sometime this coming week. I would love for you guys, as you get them, to text me and let me know that you got it and what your zip code is. That just would be helpful as we monitor that. And a couple of other things I just want to mention very quickly is, first of all, I'm very proud of you upfront sitters this week. I'm going to brag on you. Because we got a pretty full house, and if you guys weren't just filling this up front, if these were the empty seats, then folks that would come in at, you know, the last few minutes would need to come sit up here, and some are introverts and embarrassed to do that and that kind of thing. So I'm proud of you guys. I want to brag on you. My mom is here today. Yes, I'm glad of that. And Mom, glad that you are here. Hate to see you all head back to Mississippi later today, but certainly been glad to have you for a few days. And so also be watching, and I want to thank those of you that have been sharing and commenting on the social media. Those of you who use YouTube and live within, 15, 20 minutes of here, have any of you seen the YouTube ads that run for the seminar? Okay, it's interesting that we have a few thousand people a day right now watching the ads on YouTube, repeat viewers. That's kind of interesting. Don't know what that's going to mean. And also the ads on Facebook. The way they're going right now is, you know, people have been watching the short videos that we've released on good general Christian topics, some little prophecy nuggets as well. And now the videos go kind of like, be watching in your mail for this flyer. It's our personal invitation to you to be out to the series. And the idea, since we're sending these out in the mail from Kingdom City to Boonville, from Sturgeon to down south, Ashland. I was drawing a blank. I apologize. And so the idea is just to let folks know these are coming, so that hopefully for more people this won't just be a piece of junk mail, but something they've been looking to get. And so hope to have a good group out at the series. Continue to pray for those. Continue to pray for those on your soul search list, those of you who participated in that. And at this time, we go through our kid sermon quiz very quickly. We talked about a lost, was it a lost sheep, a lost coin, a lost son, or all of the above? to what did Pastor lose skiing? His driver's license, his money, his phone, or all of the above? And today, as we count the word, and pay attention in the sermon, kiddos, you're going to count the word lost. And if you keep track of that all the way through the sermon, you'll see Sister Bev. She's sitting over here today, and she'll give you a treat for paying attention. And so the message title, when we get to that in a few moments, is The Search and Celebration. Joe will be coming up now for some special announcements and to move us ahead with the service.
All right. Just a note about our building project. It's going along fine. We don't have anything at this point to report, but I know money keeps coming in, and we appreciate that, as well as money coming in for the Ukraine offering that we have initiated. To date, closely, we have $2,300 that has been given, and then the church is matching that with $1,200, so at this point, $3,500, and it will be. So, yes, that'll be very helpful over there. So we will get that sent off here soon and to the appropriate people. As you see in your bulletin, we have some transfers, membership transfers. A couple people leaving our congregation, Daniel Privo to the Mexico Church, Missouri Church, and Sarah Regal from here to Florida. And we have a family moving into our congregation. I don't see them here today, but Elliot and Joanne Williams coming from Topeka to the Columbia Seventh-day Adventist Church. How many of you would like to join me in welcoming them, as well as we always hate to see people leave, but we understand that that happens as well. So next week is potluck, and last month we had musicians come with their guitars, and we spent an enjoyable hour or so singing and having a good time. So that's going to be repeated again this coming week. Many of you know, and on a note of sadness, Verna Dye passed away this week, and her service will be here in this in our sanctuary on Friday at 11 o'clock. It'll be a 10 o'clock visitation for those that you would like to do that. So 11 o'clock next Friday for Verna's service. The offering this morning designated is Combined Youth Ministries. We are aware that that helps our education system in the conference, as well as the youth camp. So as you give your tithes and monies each month or whatever, however you do that online or on the envelope, mark that as you would like. I think that's the announcements. So I was thinking about worship this morning. Several years ago now, longer than I like to remember, I guess, I went fishing with my brother-in-law in Alaska. He'd been captain of a boat and fished for years. He grew up there. And it was my first summer that we were fishing. And they designate certain times when you can fish. And so you fish for 6 hours or 12 hours, and then you stop fishing and wait for them to open up the fishing period again. So we were done for the day. And Alaska, some of you can Google this and maybe prove me wrong. Alaska has some huge tides, 10, 12, 14 feet difference in tide. So when the tide is high, you just see water everywhere. when the tide goes out, you can hide a fishing boat behind a sandbar. So as the tide was going out, Captain Dick is his name. He wanted to get from point A to point B, and he didn't want to go the long way around, and there was some water over this obvious sandbar. And he thought, I think there's probably enough water there. So he took a nice violent run at it, and it didn't work. We got stuck. Now, if the tide would have gone totally out on that particular sandbar and we'd just gone dry, it would have been fine. But it didn't. There was some water there, and there was some wind, and so we spent the night with a boom, boom. The boat just up and down, up and down. Now, I wasn't aware enough that we were in any kind of danger until Dick said, I think we better see what those survival suits look like. He says, I'd never put one on, but we might want to see if they fit. So we did, obviously we survived the night, the boat stayed intact, but we all get kind of sometimes stuck on a sandbar, or we get stuck in our relationship with people or with God. And I don't know if it feels like the boat, boom, boom, but it's frustrating to be stuck. And I hope as we relate to each other and as we worship together, if we feel stuck somehow, we'll talk to somebody. We'll interact as a community and help each other over some of these stuck things that happen to us. Far as possible, let's kneel as we pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the freedom we have to come today and worship you. We pray for those in the war-torn sections of the world, specifically this morning in Ukraine, but we know that there are other places where people cannot worship freely. And we ask that somehow that the world leaders get together and solve what's going on. But in the meantime, please protect civilians, protect those who are in harm's way. We pray for those who are mourning this morning. Comfort them, guide them, give them the assurance that Jesus is coming soon and we will see those whom we love who have been laid to rest. Thank you for the pastor and his sermon series. Guide him as he speaks this morning. Bless us as we worship together. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I'm going to read these words for the first stanza of the song that I'm going to sing, which is Emily's favorite song. The timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell.
Timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new. That day gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen all around. Now the nations bow down to see. The only sound is the praises to Christ the King. Slowly the names from the books are read. I know the King, so there's no need to dread. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying again. And praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. See over there, there's a mansion, oh, that's prepared. Yes, just for me and you. Where I will live with my Savior eternally. There will be no more night, no more pain. Oh, never crying again. And praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb. Praises to the great I am. Oh, the reason. Oh, the reason. The reason.
It's always a blessing to have you back, Abel. Amen. Thank you for sharing. We could just have closing prayer after that. Open your Bibles to the book of Luke. We're going to be in chapter 15 today, but we're first going to jump ahead to chapter 19, which really gives us a verse that sets the theme for chapter 15. Luke 19 and verse 10, and we read here, Luke 19:10, "For the Son of Man," that's my Jesus, "for the Son of Man has come to do what? Seek and to save that which was lost." Let's go to chapter 15. As we look here in chapter 15, our message title, "The Search and Celebration." The search and celebration. We're looking at three parables in Luke chapter 15. There's the lost sheep, the woman looking for the lost coin, and then there's the lost son. There is a theme that carries through all three parables, and that is the focus on what is lost, what is found, and that it brings rejoicing. It brings celebration. So we look at the setting, Luke 15, verses 1 and 2. "Then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, 'This man receives sinners and eats with them.'" They're implying that Jesus is hanging out with bad company because he likes bad things. That's what they're implying. Okay? And tax collectors, they were despised. You probably don't have anyone in society today that is despised like the tax collectors were of that day. They worked for the Romans as Jews to help the Romans oppress the other Jews and take their money. And so, they were despised. So the tax collectors and all kinds of sinners and the scribes complained. The Pharisees and the scribes complained. And so Jesus responds to them. That is the context of these three parables. Back to back to back. Jesus doesn't address their objection directly. He says, "Let me tell you a story. Let me tell you another story. Let me tell you another story." And only at the end of the third story does he make an application to them, which without that background, a lot of people don't realize what the application for the third story is. And there's many applications, I'm sure, but the context is very clear here. So look here at this contrasting focus. They are focused on themselves and what they think God wants, and Jesus is focused on lost people. They have their focus. They're at odds with Christ because His focus is not their focus. We need to be careful as a denomination and even as a local church family that our focus is His focus. We don't need to end up like the Pharisees. They're so religious. They're so focused on right and wrong. They're so focused on supposedly serving God, but their focus is out of harmony with His focus, to the point they're ridiculing Him for fulfilling His mission. Now, we get into the first parable. Here it is. It's just a simple little story. Verse 3, "So he spoke this parable to them, saying, 'What man of you having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one which is lost until he finds it?' Now, there were several motivations there. One is a shepherd, unless he could prove that predators killed the sheep, he was responsible for it. It came out of his pay. So he's after this thing, right? "When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. When he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost.'" As I've read this, I get the idea that the idea of finding the sheep and rejoicing is being exalted just a bit. I went after a lost sheep once. I wasn't celebrating when I got back with it. I was 17. We were supposed to have 21 sheep. There were 20. Dad was off on a job out of town. I counted the sheep. There were supposed to be 21. There were 20. It was actually a mix of sheep and goats in the same pen. But I counted. There's supposed to be 21, and there's 20. Well, I had strict orders. Count them. And if they're not all there, go find what's missing. And so here it is, a rainy winter Mississippi night, and I'm a 17-year-old kid with a headlight walking in the rain in the field looking for a lost sheep. I finally found it. In the center of the field, there were some there had been some trees, and they had been cut down, and there were stumps. And so as we would bush hog the field and trim it every year, you kind of get out away from the stumps a little bit so you don't hit them with the tractor. And so brambles and briars grow up in that spot. And sure enough, one of the sheep had just got hung in the briars. I wasn't thrilled when I found him. I kind of had the idea, sheep are dumb, you shouldn't have got stuck like this. And look, one little pull and you are loose. You could have got yourself out of this. And yet here you are, and I'm out looking for you in the rain at night with a headlight. Obviously, I wasn't all that into the sheep. So I didn't come back with rejoicing. You know, aren't you thankful that God doesn't have that attitude toward us, that He has the attitude that's displayed here in this parable? When He finds that we've wandered off, when He discovers that we've left Him, that when He comes, He finds us, He picks us up, He cares for us, and He rejoices. He's not there to chastise us and say, "You dumb sheep, this is your own fault, and you shouldn't even be here." God has the attitude of being excited to have found us, to have rescued us, and to bring us back. That's the attitude of the Father revealed in the parable. And then we look at the next parable. It was an inanimate object, but it's still quite an interesting issue. The sheep was lost, it was found, there was rejoicing. Now we go to the coin. And so here it is, and it says, as we transition to that, let me read one more verse here in verse 7. "I say to you that likewise there shall be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 just persons who need no repentance." Question: do we find ourselves rejoicing over what heaven rejoices over? Guys, I'm in the same boat. I got all excited about it too. But for some reason, I can't get it off my mind the last few days. Many of us have rejoiced more over our football teams winning playoff games than over what heaven rejoices over. Just can't get that off my mind. Huh. The next parable. "Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it?" Now, the idea would be probably a one-room house with no windows back in those days. She would have her marriage portion, in this case 10 silver coins. It would be guarded. It would be like the life savings you didn't use for your average emergency, like your serious savings, which she would probably even pass on to her own daughters when they were married, kind of family heritage. And to lose one, this would be a big deal. So you can imagine the items of furniture in the little one-room house going outside, lighting a lamp. And of course, it's just hidden in the dust in the house. And so she's looking for it frantically and will not stop until it's found. And when she does, she's excited. Have you ever searched for something that aggressively, that drastically? I took the kids skiing when we lived in Washington. That's one of the things that I miss here in the Midwest, is I haven't been able to get away for the ski trips. It was real easy there. You just got the passes, drove up the mountain, and put on the skis, and there you went. You know, after the first trip or two up the chairlift, the fear of heights would ease off a little bit, and then you could enjoy yourself. For those of you that didn't have the fear of heights, it didn't matter. But I remember this one area on the mountain there where you could kind of get off the main ski area, and there were some trails that kind of went through the trees. And that can be kind of dangerous because, of course, you can hit trees. But I wouldn't go all that fast, but I like kind of getting off the beaten path, and you'd go around and dip under and come back up, and And I was having fun with that until I noticed my phone was missing. Now, I had wiped out real bad. I would probably never, it's probably a good thing I moved away from areas where you could ski, because ever since when I first went, shortly after meeting Libby when we were in college, I felt like if I didn't fall once or twice on every run, that I wasn't pushing myself adequately. You know, you got it, you know, so that was just my mindset. And so I knew this place that I had had a real bad fall, and I suspected my phone would be there. It was also an area where people would come from not being able to see you and drop right down into it and then go right out of it. And so I go over there and I'm trying to dig in the snow and look and trying not to get hit or get in the way of other skiers as they come through. Now, it wasn't just my phone. Hey, babe, can you toss my phone up here? I left it with you, but it turns out it's a sermon illustration today. Thank you. And so it had this case. I found this case years ago, and for me, it just works for me. The case of the phone has a spot for cards, so I have my driver's license and a couple of credit debit cards, whatever I need, and they all go right there. And then I hardly ever carry cash, and these days, not much at all, but my health insurance card is back in here behind the case. And I used to keep two or three hideout $100 bills just in case of an emergency. And, you know, sometimes credit card won't work. You need cash just for whatever. I remember when we were in Hurricane Katrina down in Mississippi, and there wasn't an ATM working within 100 miles. That was a problem, all right? And so I had my phone, my driver's license, my credit and debit cards, and $200 to $300. Lost. Kids' sermon quiz, what did I lose? Was it this, this, or this, or all of it? It was all of it. And so I spent half the ski day crawling around without my skis on looking for my phone. No, it was never found. Oh well, I definitely drove home without a driver's license. Well, notice verse 10. This lady looks that frantically, but she finds what she's looking for. It says in verse 9, actually, Luke 15, 9 and 10, "And when she has found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, 'Rejoice with me, I have found the peace which I lost.' Likewise, I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over," what? "One sinner who repents." You want to know what they throw a party for in heaven? You want to know what gets heaven excited? Then we look at the next story. Now, the parable of the prodigal son, parable of the lost son, I think the focus is actually in the wrong place. I think it would be more aptly named the parable of the loving father. Because now we look at the prodigal son because we more easily identify with that ourselves. Okay? Yes, we wander from God. We do things we're not supposed to. We end up in a mess and we need help. Yeah, that's us. But if you look at all three parables, the focus wasn't so much the sheep that was lost, but the shepherd that would go after it. The focus wasn't so much the coin that was lost, but that the person was bound and determined to search for it until she found it and would not be denied. And in the parable of the prodigal son, yes, we identify more with the son, but the focus of the parable as we look at it today is the father, the loving father. The biggest thing you need to remember and know if you find yourself like the lost sheep or the lost coin or the lost son is the searching and loving heart of the Father. And so we look here in this parable, and it says in Luke 15, verse 1, "Then he said, 'A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood.'" Now that's basically saying, "Dad, I know I've got some things coming when you die. I want it now." Huge disrespect in that day, of course. Now, so he would have gotten likely 1/3 of his father's goods. You say, well, there are two sons. Yes, in Bible times, it's clear in Deuteronomy, clear in the rest of Scripture, the oldest son got a double portion, and then all the others got a portion. So two sons, the eldest son would have had a double portion, and then the younger son a one-third portion. Okay? And so that's not hugely consequential to the parable, except that then he goes to a foreign land and he spends it. Verse 13, not many days after, the younger son gathered together and journeyed into a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal or wasteful living. Now, one of the things, every time I go through a passage, I've preached on the prodigal son many times. I've read this passage so many times. But it's amazing, I always see one thing that was new. One thing that was new to me, or several things usually, but at least one thing. One thing that was new to me this time, I don't know why I'd always imagined it, but I imagined he went off and that the money went fast. So maybe he left in the spring and by the fall he was broke. I actually got the idea from studying this week that this very well may have taken several years. His dad was a wealthy man, and he went off and he spent and he partied. But sometimes people party for years on some money. I was reading the book Christ Object Lessons. It gave me that idea to think about, that when he comes back, not only is he broke, but his body is wasted, and he's gone through famine, but his body is now showing the wear and tear of that party lifestyle for perhaps a number of years. And he comes home. And that also gives me another picture of the father, because it's horrible to deal with it for a few weeks or a few months with a wayward child. But it was longer, perhaps, than that. And so here we see, when he had spent all, verse 14, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. As you read the story on down, I'll just paraphrase. He got a job to feed the pigs, was the job he ended up with, which would be about the most insulting menial task that a young Jewish man could end up with especially the Jewish view of unclean and the pigs, etc. And then he hit bottom when what he was eating for food was the same thing the pigs were. I couldn't help but chuckle. I know I've shared this with you last time I preached on the parable of the prodigal son here, but verse 16, he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate. This is where he hit absolute bottom. And having come into the Adventist church and run into too much health message too quickly, and being told that this is a great substitute for chocolate chip cookies, which it was not, I can't help but chuckle every time I read the prodigal son now. And I realized that when he finally came to his senses and hit absolute bottom, what were the pods? Do you have a Bible with a marginal reference for verse 16 when it tells you what kind of pods? Yep, I heard it. What was it? Carob pods. He knew he was at the end of his rope when it was carob he had to eat. I'm sorry. Yeah, some of you don't get it. If you don't get it, don't worry about it. For those that have been in and around a bunch of health stuff, that might make sense. He hit bottom with the carob. It was time to go home. He thought, you know what? My dad has servants that are doing way better than me. I will go back and I will fall at my dad's feet. I will tell him how sorry I am, and I will ask him if I can just be one of his hired servants. Okay? And so that's where we're at in the story now. And so you've got a son who is lost. He is then found, and again they rejoice. Look at verse 20. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Verse 24. For this my son, what? Was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Lost, found, rejoice. All three parables, they go together. They were the answer to one thing, and that one thing was the Pharisees ridiculing Christ's ministry because their religious focus was not His focus. And so now Jesus applies it to the Pharisees. So far, it's all been about what the focus and mission of God is. Lost people, lost sinners. Now you've got the older brother. And it says here, now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard the music. You know why he was in the field, don't you? Because that's where Jesus wanted him when he told the story. He was in the field. So he comes home. He missed it. But now he comes back and there's music and dancing. Yes, dancing. Wow. Verse 26. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother's come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. And he was what? Angry and would not go in. Therefore, his father came out and pleaded with him. It actually ends, as you read on down, without the answer of how the older brother reacted. And I've heard the older brother applied to many things, and maybe applied to church members or even family members. And there's many, and those are probably all good applications. But do you know what the older brother was actually representing in this parable in the context in which it was originally told? This was the end of the response to the Pharisees. Jesus was ministering to the publicans and sinners and making parties happen in heaven, and they were frumpy and grumpy and upset about it. And there you have the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, and the parable of the lost son, and the application at the end back to the Pharisees. In each of the parables, you have something lost, you have something found, and you have rejoicing. Now, I've shared a story with you, but it has to be shared again in this case, because I have never seen my wife so frantically look for something in all the world than when, in about the year 2008, we came to North Central Missouri to a little town called Moberly to do an evangelistic series. And we were still traveling nationwide doing meetings. Now, Moberly, Missouri, that's actually our closest Walmart where we live now. We find ourselves there probably once or twice a week. I would love to do a meeting in Moberly again. We had a better response from our advertising there than we had anywhere else ever in the country. We did a Creation Evolution series and had 10 people per thousand off the flyer. Over 100. We had more people out in Moberly than we did in, later in Columbia. It's amazing. So Moberly, great little meeting. Staying in one of the hotels there. We'd brought two vehicles down. And we drove down from where we lived in Berrien Springs, Michigan, so about 7 hours, something like that. And Libby's car, we only brought one key for each vehicle when we came. And when we got ready to leave, I was doing a few last visits as the evangelist, and Libby was packing up the hotel room, we were getting ready to go, and we couldn't find her car key anywhere. She looked everywhere. And now, look, my wife, if you lose something at our house, she's the one that will find it. In fact, it's become a little bit of a joke with us because I give up very quickly. Because I know even if I keep looking, I can't find it. Because I can't find stuff when I lose it. And then I just need to ask her to look for it because she will find it because she finds stuff when we lose it. And she constantly would like me to put a little more effort into finding it, but I'm like, what's the use? I'm not going to find it anyway, and you will. And so, anyway, she was looking for this key. She looked everywhere. She went through all the luggage. She went through all the room. She went through everything multiple times. She finally started going through the trash. Now, we had two little girls. Jackson, who's sitting here, not even thought about yet. We had Savannah and Lauren. And Savannah was a tiny baby, and Lauren was about that high. And Lauren had dolls, and she liked to play with her dolls, and her sister Savannah had real diapers, and she would take Savannah's real diapers and put them on her dolls, and then she would change the diapers. Well, you know, a lot of times when Mom would change the diapers, there would be stuff in them, and the diaper would need to be wrapped up. Well, Lauren must have thought, something needs to be in the diaper so I can wrap it up. She put the car key. I guess it was symbolic of, in her mind, of something to put in the diaper. And so she had put the car key in the diaper, and then she, with its own tabs, taped it up and threw it away. Yes, when the key was finally found, it was found in what appeared to be it. That's how aggressive my wife gets when she wants to find something. She was going through the garbage and got to the point she was looking in dirty diapers. And she found that car key. But do you know why she looked so aggressively for it? Because we couldn't go home without it. What if we adopted the mission of Jesus? And what if we focus so intently on missing members and the lost in our community that we sought them as if we couldn't go home without them? What if we did that? What if we focused on what makes heaven celebrate even more every day? You had the sheep that wandered away. Have you wandered away? You had the coin that was lost in the house. It was lost in the house, in the church, but didn't even know it. And a son that left in willful rebellion. And in all three cases, we see the heart of God. The heart of God yearning to bring them back, searching for that which was lost, and throwing a party when it's found. Romans 5:8 says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Are you lost today? Have you wandered away? Are you lost in the church like the coin? Or have you been in willful rebellion? What you need to know is right where you're at right now is the heart of God to you. The heart of God to you is one of love, who is searching without condemnation to deliver His love to you and bring you home. And if you're saved in the church today, here's a mission for you. To focus on what is lost until it is found, and then do what? Rejoice. I'm going to read to you Psalms 126, 5 and 6 very quickly. I believe it goes with this. Psalms 126, 5 and 6 comes to mind. I wasn't planning to go here, but I feel like I should. Psalms 126, 5 and 6. Those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. The idea of sowing is planting, but you're still going forth. And in this case, it's in sorrow. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing precious seed for sowing, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. You go forth. It may be in sorrow, but you're looking, you're searching, or you're planting seed. And the Scripture says, without a doubt, you will come again with rejoicing, because there will be a harvest. Here's a challenge I give you today. Your mission. What if we saw our missing members is so important to be found and brought back that we couldn't go home without them? We've all got access, if we want it, to a church directory now that's pretty up to date and getting better every day. And if you don't, the information's in the church bulletin. You can have it in the next day or two. We all have the ability to go through it on our own and see, you know what? I don't know that I've seen this person since COVID. I don't know. Each of us can seek to be the hands and feet of Jesus. You don't need a board approval. You don't need any certain type of organized effort, although an organized effort would be great, and we've tried some of those. Every single one of us can seek those who are missing because we have the ability to do so. Here's another one for you. So that's one option. You say, make it real. Well, I'm making it real. I just brought it real close to home. Real close to home for us all. Here's another one. What about the lost persons? We interact with them at work. They're in our friendship groups, at school, in our neighborhood. That just a word of encouragement, sharing a book, a tract, inviting to a series, or just showing them the love of Jesus, we can be the hands and feet of Jesus and help heaven have a party. Loving Father, we thank you that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost, and that was us. And now, Lord, as we have been sought and saved by you, we now can be your hands and feet to join you in your mission to seek and to save that which was lost. Help us to be used of you to that end and help another party happen in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Your kids' sermon quiz. We talked about a lost. Was it a lost sheep, a lost coin, or a lost son, kiddos? Or was it D, all of the above? We talked about them all. That's right. And this is the all above, all of the above week, isn't it? Number two, what did Pastor Lou ski in? His driver's license, his money, his phone, or again, D, all of the above? Driver's license, yeah? All of the above, that's right. Definitely included the license, though. And then how many times today did we say the word lost? I don't know, but Sister Bev does. She's sitting right back there. You can see her after we dismiss if you followed along and kept count today so you can get your treat. Thank you. We've had prayer. You are dismissed.